white.
Life's kind of troubling waters.
It looked like a bend of the Israelite.
Life's kind of troubling waters. Waiting in the water. Waiting in the water, children. Waiting in the water.
With comments?
Yes. Good ones try to, but the bad ones don't. They don't have them to do with you. But you're not high enough for them. Okay, the bad ones are, you know.
Okay, that's usually a disclaimer on my lectures. It's usually rated PG-13. I don't know if the little kids should be.
But I'm not taking chances. I'm warning you now. I'm
going
to make
you think you
don't want to. You want to? That button.
Right.
Yes, yes, yes.
Ready to go?
Okay.
Okay, we're going.
Not you. Not you,
Dale. My name is Rick. And, usually I start off by giving a couple things I want to bring to your attention, which relates to this lecture in a big way. A friend of mine by the name of George Haas has written a new book. It came out towards the end of 2005. It's called The Sidonia Codex. It's in the syllabus, which is why a lot of things I'll mention are already listed in the syllabus. If it's not, I'll tell you. It's extremely important that you read a book like that because it deals with the direct connection between what's referred to as the geoglyphs on Mars and the geoglyphs and cultural icons of Mesoamerica, that being South America, Mayan, Incan, and Aztec, and Olmec. The connection being that what he refers to as Olmecs, he identified with me as what I was referring to as the Moorish legacy. Okay? Sidonia Codex is a big key to understanding the relationship between Mars and Earth. Both he and I had agreed that one of the biggest reasons that NASA keeps burying this stuff, that there's hundreds of geoglyphs out there. I'm sure you've heard of Richard Hoagland, but what he had done would be seen as juvenile compared to what George Haas and William Saunders have done with the Sidonia Codex. It's 10 years worth of research. And it was far, far above and beyond what now would be just juvenile shenanigans, what you referred to as the face on Mars. The stuff they get into relates to the people of color and hue here on Earth, the Mesoamerican cultures of South America, who of course came from the Olmecs of Africa. And he and I were talking, and one of those geoglyphs is the image of a primate with negroid-like features and the headdress of an Egyptian. And there's no way in hell that white NASA is going to let that get out to the general mainstream public because you'd be admitting too much, okay? That just gives you a really, you know, just a glimpse at what we're going to get into. About myself, I was just talking to someone over here, but let's go over a few things. We'll do the lecture here is that I'll give a brief introduction to myself. Overview of experiences, what brought us to this understanding, mentors, and inspirations, and the missing piece. Then I'll explain how the lecture is structured. We'll get through that in hopefully about 15 minutes, because there is a limited amount of time to this tonight, and it's like kind of like 5 hours of information packed into 2 hours, all right? My first awakening came at the age of 21, and in that awakening, I was shown everything that had happened before, childhood on up to the age of 21, and everything that would be happening with me into the near future. Okay. During that time, what was happening was now I can say this. I'm 36 years old. I have some basis to go from. I've looked back over time and realized that there's been a pattern every 10 years on the 11th year. And what I mean by that is that it wasn't just something that took place at the age of 21. 10 years before that, at the age of 11, there was also something else that took place. My mother and I together, viewing this from the perspective of being a generational phenomenon. My mother and I both witnessed a very first bona fide UFO experience. Then at the age of 21, I have this extraterrestrial awakening. The significance of that is that at that point, the entity that I refer to in my book as Mother, and I also refer to it as the Crone, it came to me. And at that point in time, it just so happens to coincide with the fact that I was deciding to go back to school at SUNY Westbury to refocus my efforts more so on fine art instead of commercial art. And that's where I ended up finding myself. But in finding myself, people don't seem to realize when I say that, there's a lot more behind that. Finding myself, it coincides with the extraterrestrial experience with the Crone coming and explaining a few things to me about what had been going on, not only with me, but with the family in general. And this is when it was made aware to me that this not only wasn't just about me, although it was culminating with me, it had to do with my mother and my grandmother, and maybe even back further than that, and this is how it becomes a generational thing in my family. Some people have asked, in reference to the feminine goddess energy, why would it be passed on to a man whose position was grandmother to mother? Shouldn't have been the daughter. There were no girls in my family. My whole generation of kids were all boys. But as we go along in this lecture, I think you realize why the mantle of responsibility was passed on to a white Caucasian male who has a lot more power with his voice than anybody else because of the racist mentality of the issues we're dealing with. Okay? And the pattern continued. In the introduction of my book, I actually talk about the most recent part of that pattern or cycle came yet another 10 years after the age of 21 and 31. So you create 11, 21, 31. At the age of 31, I was going through a very difficult trial and tribulation in my life personally. Okay? And it had to do with someone else who was also equally involved with this, with someone I refer to in the book, The Telling Mermaid. There were issues going on at a time that was almost like baptism by fire, okay? And by the time the year 2001 came along, she had to go her way, I had to go mine. There were two different things taking place there, and we couldn't stay together anymore. That brought about a different kind of an awakening, and it's around this time that I end up having another extraterrestrial experience where an entity associated with the Crone ends up coming to me and says, you know, grabs me by the arm and says, what the hell are you waiting for? Get going, okay? It's from my early 30s on, the last 6 years, that my focus on the paranormal, where I was in my 20s, you know, was one thing. Where I am now in my 30s is much different. In fact, what I talk about now, I never would have understood really 10 years ago. I probably would have gotten it, but I never would have understood the significance. Here I am now at the age of 36, and what has culminated over the last 5 years since the age of 31 is that I've gone in a direction that has a much more solid foundation for it. And what I mean by that is that the abduction phenomena by itself, Freemasonry by itself, doesn't work. And this is why you get these asshole white academics who get away with saying, oh, that doesn't exist. Well, that's funny because if I ask members who represent the other 70% of the population, that being people of color and you, also known as the sun-kissed people of Earth, I seem to get a different answer. Okay? So you got 70% of the planet. Blacks, Hispanics, Native Americans, Asians, okay? Anyone who's seven shades darker than me, giving me one answer, and you've got this other elite 30% Caucasian pale skin saying something completely different, going against the grain of truth that represents the majority. So I was getting to a certain point where about 2 years ago, Peter Moon and I hooked up again. I've known Peter Moon since 1994. around 2004, we had hooked up again, and he knew intuitively where I was going. As a matter of fact, he turns out to be one of my mentors. He ends up walking out to me at one of his meetings, hands me this giant book. It's about yay thick and square like this, okay? It's in the syllabus. I do recommend you take the time to study it. I'm about one third of the way through it. I'm still reading it because it's got a little tiny type like this going down every page. But he sends it to me, and I look at it, and it says, biography of Noble Drill Lady. He says, well, I know about this. He says, I've been involved in getting to know the Moorish legacy. He says, but I have not read this. He says, this is for you. He just gives it to me. I said, well, what do you want for it? The book is about $100. And he says, I don't want anything for it. He says, this is what you need to go the rest of the way. And I said, okay. So I read it. It's written by a legal pleasant day. From what I understand, through Peter Moon, he's recently spoken to the author, Pleasant Day. And he definitely wants to talk to me and get in touch with me because he's never heard of a white guy getting out there talking about this stuff. So this is like an enigma and an anomaly to him as well. But it was bound to happen at some point. Okay. So at one point, as far as this of course helped formulate a better structure for doing these kind of lectures. And of course, during the time period of my experiences with the Crone, one of the things that she had taught me, we had, these were like educational paranormal experiences. This is why I have a hard time associating with what's referred to customarily as the abduction phenomena. A lot of those issues, people, they have a victim complex, and that wasn't me. So early on, even in my 20s, I felt like there was something different about me that didn't exactly fit. These people feel like if they're breaking over hot coals, I feel like I'm Superman. So there's something going on here. One of the things that the Crone had burned into me was that she would not always be there. Things would happen. She would have to make a major sacrifice and decide what side she was on finally. Because, of course, she's part of this extraterrestrial council, and as with everything, there's good and bad on any council. And they were looking for an excuse to label her as a traitor, treasonous, because she had the stench of humanity on her, because she decided to side with human beings. And the Crone is what you might refer to as one of the praying mantis types, an ancient healer, okay? Been around since, time immemorial, very ancient race, and only a few of them left. So, it's a very tall, 9 feet over me, okay? But one of the things she says is, since I will not always be here for you, she says, you will come across others, mentors of your own kind. She says, you will listen to them, men and women. She says, they will teach you the things you need to know to fill in the gaps so that you can go the rest of the way. That was the other major realization that came in the early 30s, was that a lot of these mentors and teachers, a lot of them were white, but they were getting information from people who were all of color and hue. And that was another realization, too, is that where were they getting the information from, okay? With that in mind, I can tell you why the lecture is structured the way it is, what it says on the syllabus, history, health, and wealth, okay? The reason I labeled it that is because those are the three. That's the holy trinity of a true democracy, which of course we do not have, which is why I'm talking about it. And you can envision it as three major volumes on the shelf of a library: history, health, and wealth. Okay? In which case you would need bookends to hold up those volumes, and in this case the bookends I'm referring to would be linguistics and economics. Okay? And one person asked me about the end of September of last year, I was up in Yonkers. Someone asked me, can you tell us about, what's the deal with the reptilian issue? I said, if you want to understand that thing, okay, that whole issue with abduction phenomena and reptilian contact, you must first learn about real estate investing. I said, there is nothing that you can learn in a vacuum. I said, the only way to truly understand what's going on with the abduction phenomena is to understand economics. And the only way to learn about economics is to learn about real estate investing, because that is the backbone of the economic structure on this planet, global real estate investing. Okay? Investing in tradable commodities. There are two concepts I want you to keep in mind through everything I talk about. Flesh and bone, the investment in humanity, versus wood and stone, the investment in the tradable commodities and real estate that humanity lives on. Okay? This is the two feuding interests. But some others would say, you know, benevolent factions versus malevolent factions. This, of course, leads to the title of the book, Legions of Light, Armies of Darkness, Flesh and Bone versus Wood and Stone. Okay? So this is, you know, history helped him up. The way the lecture is done, and granted, it might get through the history section, I'll consider it a success. There's stuff from the health and wealth part of the lecture that I'll just disperse throughout his background info. We may not get to that part of it. Like I said, there's a lot to talk about just as the history part. And even though I call it history, health, and wealth, the real vision you should have in your mind is that the history is used as the foundation, and the health and wealth issues are then built on top of that. Okay? So we don't necessarily have to get to those things, although they are key components to understanding history in a repetitive, pattern-like cycle, as the old phrase goes, you know, those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it over and over. Mark Twain said some kind of variation like that. The two aspects of the lecture to keep in mind is, one of my mentors, his name is Phil Sparks, he does a lot of the hollow earth stuff. He heard me talking one day, he says, come here, he says, you have, much the same way that Peter Moon did. He says, come here, I have to show you something, you need to know about this. He ends up exposing me to the Robert Morning's guide, cosmology. When I start talking about it, it's going to sound like I'm talking about the Zachariah Sitchin cosmology. Okay? The big difference is, Robert Morning's guide, who of course is a Native American from the Hopi tribe of Southwest America, his makes, you know, a lot more sense, and it's coming from a person of color and hue. And the reason his makes more sense is because it approaches the issue from the perspective of a C corporation, real estate investing, tradable commodities, and the structure of economics therein. Okay? In other words, feudalism. Whereas, even though I love Zachariah Sitchin, the problem is he comes at it from the perspective of a Judeo-Christian perspective. You can't approach the damn thing like that because it'll be skewed off in the wrong direction. Okay? I have no respect for Christianity to begin with. It's useless. It's a white man's religion. It was never meant for people of color and hue. I feel bad for black Christians because they're in for a sad awakening. All right? In fact, get the hell out now. Because when I'm done decimating Christianity, you're going to be running back to Egypt and Islam for solace, okay? Anyway. Robert Morning Sky Cosmology and the Temple of Solomon History, Noble Jerusalem. Alright. Before I jump in, just make sure. Okay, and as an extension of the lecture, in 2005, when I was down in New Jersey talking at the Earth Mysteries Conference with Pat Montatilio, there was this little lady sitting in the front row. She was feverishly trying to keep up with her, rattling off stuff left and right. And at the end of the lecture, she walked up to me and politely asked me, she says, next time you do this, she says, could you put together something and hand it out? And of course, at that time, it gave me the idea of, okay, I can't be everywhere at once, but I can hand out something that can go everywhere at once. And that's when the creation of the syllabus came into existence. The syllabus is not for shits and giggles, it's for you, okay? I don't just do it for my health, the damn thing's 15 pages long. It takes time to staple that shit together, okay? So, that's for you guys. It's free. People look at me like, I'm nuts, why don't you charge money for it? I sell a book for 12 bucks, who cares? So, the syllabus is extremely important because it represents my footprints in the sand. wherever I leave off, whatever we don't get to cover, and whenever I'm not there, you've got that to go with. So you can follow in my footsteps. It's me on paper, okay? So that you don't need me. After this, okay, you can go your own way, all right? So that's the point of it. And the syllabus is always evolving and growing over time. The syllabus is always available in its updated, newest format from the website, ufoteacher.com. There's a direct PDF link right on the main splash page. You can always go there and get it or recommend it to someone else. If you don't have a copy on hand, just go there. Go to the website, download the PDF, print it on yourself. Voila. That's how you can spread it around the world as well, without me. Okay? Then I won't be here forever either. But the syllabus will. Okay? So from that, we get into the very essence and the conceptual understanding of the lecture. When I had my first awakening at the age of 21, and then later on, followed through at the age of 31, what was happening along the way was this manufactured, fabricated thing called the ego was being shattered in me. By the time I reached the age of 31, it was completely shattered, destroyed, split down the middle. What I'm about to say is going to sound like I'm fucking about Freudian psychoanalysis, but I'm not endorsing that. I just need a place to begin to explain it to you guys, that's all. When it got split, of course, what did it split into? The superego and the it, okay? What that really means is that from it, ego, and superego, you get self, soul, and spirit, okay? That's the metaphysical equivalent, all right? The next level you would go to of significance would be understanding the self, of course, is the flesh, the soul, and then the spirit. What this relates to with narcissism and numerology is the idea of numbers, 666, 777, 888, okay? And one of the biggest misunderstandings throughout history is that you get these nut jobs, once again, white Christians, they'll say, oh, 666, the work of the devil. And there's a reason why they say that is because Christianity is a pulpit of propaganda for Freemasonry, white Freemasons, all right? So they don't want you waking up to anything that I'm telling you. What I am telling you is forbidden. This is why my head is wanted on a silver platter, because I'm not supposed to be talking to you about this stuff. But the thing is, 666 is the beast. But the question was, and the question that nobody ever bothered to ask was, who the hell is the beast? Okay? The beast is the man, you, me, the next door neighbor. That is the beast. And the beast is the slave, henceforth the consumer slave. Another concept, like I said before, flesh and bone versus wood and stone, another concept to keep in the back of your mind. There are two kinds of people in the world. And you need to decide what side of the playing field you're on. Those two kinds of people are consumer slave or master investor. Right, this relates to the symbolism again. I use the term master investor. It comes straight out of the real estate arena in economics, but it can be used as a metaphor for anything. You can be a master investor at anything. Spirituality, economics, history, you know, religion, ufology, you know, it doesn't matter what you're related to. The point is, number 666 is man, that's the beast, the consumer slave. 777 in between represents transcendence, the trials of life. That path that you go on to stop thinking like a consumer slave and move into the mentality of a master investor. Which, of course, leads you to 888, infinity, Godhood. This is what the number 8 represents, infinity in the first place. It is the symbol for infinity. Also known as Jumachu or Jumachi, it is a state of completion, and that's why I use the term master investor, because once you get out of the rut of thinking like a consumer slave or being in the rat race, you start thinking like a master investor, you get on the fast track, and that fast track could be anything. It could be money, it could be knowledge, okay? It could be traveling, could be visionary, philosopher, okay, someone like me going on the warpath. From that level of understanding, you get into the area of philosophy and free association, which would be exploration, utilization, and revelation. This is third circular thought, because every time you get to the level of revelation, you're back to more questions again, and you're re-exploring. This is also known as the power of creation for artists and gods, right? From exploration and utilization and revelation, you get into, now of course, the symbolism of the lecture itself, history, health, and wealth, all right? Now, there's always going to be adversarial linchpins to understanding why this understanding why these symbolisms exist at all, this layered understanding. Those linchpins, the things that you would have to knock down like a domino effect in order to get to the truth. For history, it would be retrosyrian fascism. I'll explain that term. Extraterrestrial intervention and Freemasonry. For health and wellness, it would be an invasion of the body, mind, and spirit, which is also known as the Temple of Solomon. Okay? And this, of course, leads right to the abduction phenomenon, which is a rape and molestation of the Temple of Solomon, your body. Polluting the body, pharmaceutical multinationals, poisoning the gene pool and the bloodstream of the family of man. People of color and you, okay? Keeping the beast asleep. Remember, we're all very much with the idea that the beast is an exterior entity or prince of darkness, okay? The beast is within itself, and that's the thing you need to conquer, because that'll always be your worst enemy, the reflection you see in the mirror. From the in terms of health and wellness, body, mind, and spirit, abduction phenomena, the cancer industry. When I talk about the health issues, the ultimate linchpin is to topple and destroy the cancer industry. I don't care what disease you have. It could be anything from AIDS to Alzheimer's, diabetes, arthritis, into Hodgkin's disease. I don't care. Ebola. The first and most important thing to kill off is the cancer industry. Because once you crack that baby wide open, everything else falls into place. Okay? This is the biggest money-making, multi-billion dollar gamble. Okay? And there are very effective, healthy, alternative ways of permanently destroying cancer in your own body without hacking off limbs and ripping out lungs and turning the body into a chunk of meat that isn't even worth keeping alive anyway. At that point, you might as well just put a gun to your head and pull the trigger. As far as wealth and money, the linchpin is, of course, now in real estate investing, which is a good thing. I'm not painting it as a bad thing, but it's where all the power and knowledge is, okay? Then we get into, the bad stuff. Economic slavery, revenue service, which is the ultimate linchpin, the domino effect, just like the cancer industry. Remember, the IRS is an external corporate entity hired by the United States government. So you're being controlled by an external corporation, which of course goes with the flow of retrosyrian fascism and Freemasonry anyway. Okay. The rest of it is broken down into the sections of the lecture itself, history, health, and wealth, plus other additional sections towards the back, linguistics, the dating game. I've started that section putting key dates that you guys should remember. I put words in the linguistics section to remind you of the things we'll be talking about today so that you don't forget. Okay? And these areas are always being updated. Alright? Now, what I want to start off with is I'm going to write things on the board on two sides. I'm going to try and do it that way. And we'll be talking about terminology, where words come from, words we take advantage of, and take advantage every day. Angel, demon, shadow, God, stuff like that. Where they actually come from, and you'd be surprised to realize that most of the words that you take for granted every day in that particular sense all came from an extraterrestrial source and extraterrestrial dialect. Okay? but aside from that, what I'll do is kind of like split things into two on either side of the board. This side will be symbolisms relating to the Moorish legacy. This side will be symbolisms relating to the Masonic agenda. Okay? In fact, I'll do that right now. And Masonic agenda. Never get that. I have to always win these things from the hip. And hope I get it right, which is another reason why I have a syllabus, because it serves as a traveling chalkboard. Okay? So how did all this stuff start? Well, now I've got to the point. concept being flesh and bone versus wood and stone. Or, in terms of the Moorish legacy, the lamp of illumination versus the iron hand of oppression. Okay? Lamp of illumination versus iron hand of oppression. Flesh and bone, wood and stone. Okay? Some time ago, which is an understatement, you guys will realize I'm horrible with dates. Do not ask me to date something. You'll have to figure that out yourself. I like chronology, but I do not like dating, because our dating system sucks anyway. And when we try to date things, this is when we get into screaming matches because someone's dating system wasn't correct in the first place. So how the hell do I relate to dates outside? I can use a vagary of like 500,000 years ago to 76 billion years ago. But now, who can relate to that? If you can't relate to it, then why the hell bother asking? Okay? I'm lucky if I can remember 10 years ago, alright? But the situation was this. There was a kingdom called the Arians, okay? And the kings, spelled like this, Arians, okay? Arians. Singular. Kings wanted to expand the empire. Okay? Now you're going to use, I have to, in terms of linguistics right off the bat, okay? I'm going to tell you two terms that come from this. Can you guys see one already?
Arian.
Arian, okay. That one will go down here. Arian, as an Arian super race. And you're going to notice that there's always, with these bastards, there's always a favoritism towards the male skin. Okay? Alright?
Okay.
Arian. And up here, Orion. That's where the term Orion comes from. I had to bring that up now because I'm going to use the phrase Orion Empire. You needed to know that I'm really talking about the Arian Empire. Okay? This is where scientists get the word Orion, constellation, which doesn't come from science. It comes from Native Americans and Native Africans. Okay? Alright? Just looking to the Dogon tribe. Alright, so science does not get this stuff by itself. It goes to people of color and healing and claims it as its own. Alright? The Orion Empire, which is already big enough, wanted to expand its borders somewhat. So they start pushing outward, and the kings are happy with how far it goes, okay? And after a while, you know, they're pretty happy with what they've done. Okay, but the thing was, along the way, they started teaching it to the women, the queens. Okay, now the queens, gotta remember, you know, we're talking about the female side of the species. In any case, the queens got a taste for this. Okay, and it turned out they really liked doing this whole expanding the empire, running the operation type thing. And they realized they could do it even better than the kings, because the kings got, you know, they figured, oh, we have enough, who cares? The queens got hungry and wanted to go further and further, okay? This is interesting in terms of, once again, the corporate structure. Keep it in the back of your mind. You'll notice in corporate America, there's this one white chairman, CEO at the top, and the people looking through the glass ceiling are a whole bunch of female VPs surrounding him. And the reason he surrounds himself with female VPs is because the women will work twice as hard as the male VPs to accomplish what the head honcho white CEO wants. And they'll keep looking through the glass ceiling because he keeps promising them things that'll never come true. This is repeated over and over again in the Masonic structure of lodges, where you have the white Freemason and the female Masons thinking they're equal. If they go to any country club, how's it split up? The men go upstairs, women go downstairs. Okay? That country club split, I know this for a fact, because I was a waiter at one of these ritzy country clubs on the North Shore of Long Island. I saw this for myself. This was during the 90s. like, you know, we're approaching the 21st century and these country clubs are still segregated like this because the country club mentality is the Masonic mentality, all right? He says, well, the country clubs are all Christian, in some cases Jewish, okay? Christian and Jewish country clubs, all right? I don't see any black country clubs like that or Native American country clubs. In fact, if it was Native American, the women would be on top because they're held in high regard and they're the ones that make all the rules and the decisions. So it's only in white America that you see this as backwards function where women are forcibly subjugated onto their knees, right? So in any case, the women got a taste for this and they decided to take over the operation. The kings were like, all right, go ahead, do it. They were happy with what they had, they didn't care. So the queens take over. Now these, there was an elite group of queens who really got into this. And they were called the Sitar queens. Now, can you see what's going to come out of that already? Okay, think about it. There's two things that come out of this. Being that they were such wretched bastards to begin with, you've got an ancient reference that comes out in the Jewish Torah called Satan, okay? Okay? And of course, Nazi Germany had a very close affinity with the Anunnaki who served these guys. So from here, you get the Schutzstaffel, SS, all right? So, keep in mind, things I've learned over the last 16 years or so makes it very difficult for me to look at the Nazi Party in black and white anymore. There are a lot of fantastic, awesome things they were trying to do, but absolute power corrupts absolutely. It went the wrong way. It was done that way and sabotaged on purpose, right? To their credit, the Nazis hated Masons with vengeance and wanted to hunt them all down. You don't do that to upper management, okay? Masons are upper management, okay? Masons are upper management. The Nazis were middle management trying to become the new upper management. And upper management said, fuck that, okay? All right? So that's what happened to the third upper management stepped on them, all right? And once you understand from that, it becomes very hard to just say, oh, well, the Nazis were all bad when there was this other hypocritical bullshit going on in the background, all right? We see that history, jumping ahead a little bit, history repeating itself again. We're so busy pointing fingers at Nazis and saying, oh, they're all bad. Well, they're the ones that gave us our space program. If there were no Nazis, there'd be no 1969 going to the moon, okay? On top of that, because we refused to learn from history the right way, that Nazi party and all the bullshit that went on with it could never come back in the form of neocons. Here, George Bush pulled the same shit that Hitler tried to pull. And in bombing the World Trade Center, they bombed upper management. Upper management once again said, fuck that, okay? And stepped on Bush, stepped on his administration. You notice all of his kingpins have been taken away from him. Now he's backed into a corner like a lame duck president, okay? And it really wasn't his, this is what happens, we're so busy pointing fingers at imaginary bad guys. We seem to forget the fact that the bad guys are here, okay? Power moves across the planet like a vortex, okay? Case in point, what is New York City will eventually become Hong Kong, China, okay? Power moves like a vortex, and after, the World Trade Center was the center of Western power for the Illuminati and the Western arm of power for the World Trade Organization. Going after that totally overstepped their bounds, and the neocons knew they bit off more than they could chew. Okay? But that's just, I throw these things in there so you understand the full corporate structure of what's happening on the planet and how everything repeats itself in the grand scheme of things. All right? So top queens are going out, they're pushing out. Now, of course, through this expansion, they end up associating themselves with another empire, a younger empire, but just as vicious, hostile, and powerful. And that other younger empire was known as the Canis. The Canis Empire. The the Orion Empire, Canis Empire. Canis, what you refer to as Syrians, okay? From Canis, what does it look like? Two words. Canis, they were, what you refer to today, if you were to see a dog walking on two legs, bipedal canines, okay? From Canis, you get canine, and you also get cannibal, okay? Now, the reason you get cannibal is not just because of the linguistic connection, but also because the Canis Empire had an elite group of warriors called the Dooks, okay? So from there, you have Dooks, it was spelled like this, D-K. Remember, vowels are just a crutch. If you don't learn about language, you're going to realize vowels are absent from ancient history, okay? Because remember, language comes from Sanskrit first, and then is translated to Greek tablets, papyrus, paper, okay? Duk, okay, they were known as, they were known as the Duks of War. This is where Shakespeare got the phrase, dogs of war. From Duk, you get the term dog. They were Syrians, and this is how they come to become known as the dog race. So from Duk, you get the word dog. Dogs of war, Duks of war. And the cannibalism part, coming from the name, also came from their method of warfare, which was just to simply eat the enemy right on the battlefield. Okay? Now, if you're going to run a corporation, you can't eat the employees, okay? So, the Arians, the top queens, went to the Canis feudal lords, once again, the ultimate form of government being feudalism everywhere. This democracy will go back to feudalism, like it or not. The Arians, trying to run an establishment here and a relationship with them, they were feuding with each other, and they realized it's more profitable to work together, okay? What you see, the friction between these two is no different than the friction that was caused during the Civil War in this country, and the only reason the Civil War was brought to an end was because it was more economically feasible to bring it to an end. No one was making money off the war, so it's time to bring it to an end. Here, they were losing money, destroying everything in sight, laws of supply and demand. It comes to a certain point where war starts destroying the profits that you initially started the war for in the first place. Then you need to stop it. So they decided it was more profitable to work together. And this is where the Ariad Empire and the Canis Empire, the Syrians, Orion, joined forces, tentatively working together. It's not like they were hugging each other and kissing, okay? What happens is that because the Sakak queens were spreading so far out, this relationship here between the younger and the older empire began what is now known today as the two-party system. This is the original two-party system right here, okay? Now, in that two-party system, somebody makes the rules and the other one carries out the dirty work. The Sata queens made the rules, passed the laws, decreed. Canis carried out the dirty work. They were feudal lords, okay? Feudal lords. What's interesting is that as I go along in this lecture, you will also see me interspersing references and symbolisms from the Invisible College, art, literature, film, and science fiction in a lot of cases. These feudal lords you see depicted in Stargate SG-1, or the movie Stargate, those feudal lords, okay? Here, you're talking about, if you're looking for good depictions, the Satans, the Reptilians, there's this great bounty hunter, and played a very small role. In Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back, Bosk, the Reptilian, standing right there next to the Boba Fett. That's your Reptilian, okay? Here, dogs of war, Syrians. You ever see the movie The Howling? Stand on two legs, you see them stand up like that? That's your Syrian, okay? That's how scary it gets seeing these damn things. Imagine the bounty hunter in one of those werewolves, okay? From these feudal lords, there was, of course, where the term comes from, feuding. Syrian, the Syrians being a younger empire, they also feuded amongst themselves. Why? Because they were buying favoritism from the Safavid queens. Okay? The Safavid queens decided to pick one over all others, and they favored him over all others. And that one that they picked was known as Anu. Okay, a Syrian feudal lord, Anu. Alright? Now, from Anu, since Anu was favored by them, it made it much easier for, as you see with the mafia or any kind of criminal organization, what do you do first? You want a monopoly, you eliminate the competition. But you need backing from the crime syndicate to do that. This was the crime syndicate, backed up Anu, gave him carte blanche to go out and kill up all the other feudal lords, eliminating the competition. And what was he doing that for? Why was he favored? Okay, with the expansion of the empire came the discovery of this solar system, okay, in a much younger state of existence. And what made it so fantastic to discover was because, once again, concepts, wood and stone, they discovered rich and valuable tradable resources within the kingdom. And when I use the term kingdom, kingdom is supposed to reference solar system. Okay? When in any kind of Gnostic or religious literature, when you see the word kingdom, they're talking about solar systems. Okay? And in each and every solar system, no different than real estate here on one planet, okay? In each and every solar system, in keeping with the idea feudal structure, corporate structure, there is always one planet that's going to be used as the throne of power. In this case, it's Earth. Earth is the throne of power. This goes a hell of a long way to explaining why they were so interested in coming here to this backwater system, okay? And a lot of the naysayers and academics are like, you know, why would they come here if we're such a bunch of ignoramuses and we're only interested in tribal warfare, and it's the best we can do at this point. I mean, we started off the 21st century with a bang, literally, by going and invading the Middle East. This doesn't really exactly speak well of alien contact, though. But the interest from that side of it is the tradable commodities within the entire solar system, not just this planet. But this planet is the throne of power, so it has to be given that due respect first, and this is where you get all the wars and feuding over controlling this throne, because legally, by feudal law, when you control the throne, you control all the other commodities within that system, within that kingdom, in this case, the other planets, the other real estate. Okay? This is also what made this solar system something worth fighting over, because of all the rare and rich, valuable, tradable commodities that were found here. And of course, it's because of the ambition of the females that this system was found at all. Okay? But them being the elitist pigs that they are, they're not going to get their hands dirty by doing the work themselves. Why? Because in this two-party system, they are upper management, they are middle management. Middle management gets stuck with the job of doing the dirty work, okay? Middle management, this is why they favored him, okay? They bloated his ego and said, you're the one who won. Meanwhile, they just wanted someone, some lackey to do the work. So they sent him down. Now he's King Anu, so of course he too is not going to get his hands dirty. What does he do? He sends his vicious, sadistic pig of a son called Enlil. Okay? So from Anu, you get Enlil. Prince Enlil. King Anu, Prince Enlil. Okay? Now Enlil did not want to come here. But this shows you how powerful the treaties and agreements and feudal law is between these two empires, to the point where he could force his son to do this, or else you're dead, okay? When they come knocking on your door and say, you go here, you go, otherwise you get your throat slit. Enlil, under protest, came down to this system, and his job was to basically you know, stuff used, mine the tradable commodities within the solar system. He didn't want to be here. He had his own form of mental management. Okay? He had, based on Anu's name, he had the Anunnaki. Okay? Now, what's interesting about this is that the we can split this, but linguistically, if we can split this down the middle, by Anunnaki, Anu is faithful, okay? Alright? Because of King Anu, alright? But there's a second hand here. Now, I can only say this just on intuition alone. I find it quite interesting that Anunnaki, you have the third Reich associating themselves with this cosmology as being the rightful heirs to the throne. From Naki, you get this pronunciation Nazi. Okay? Can't prove it, but it's a strong intuition, something to think about, alright? Anu's Naki, Anu's Nazis, alright? And they talked about the Anunnaki all the time. They were very into that stuff, alright? For better or worse, they knew all about this stuff. So, Anil comes around using the Anunnaki, okay, to start digging out the rich and raw materials from the mines, coal, diamonds, gold, okay, silver, copper, nickel, right, all that stuff. Anunnaki, though, they're like royal guards. They're our elite warriors, okay? They've been busy fighting with the reptilians, and all of a sudden they're denigrated as a slave laborer. This pissed them off, okay? Remember, Enlil is playing the role of upper management, and Anunnaki playing the role of middle management. There's always the two-party system, you know, okay? Always that kind of structure. Either if upper management wants to remain upper management, they got to keep middle management happy. Middle management's now ready to revolt and pissed off. Like, we don't have to do this slave labor. You're making us do something that is totally out of our rank, all right? So, Enlil goes back to his father and says, I'm having a problem here. We're going to lose this system if we don't get this under control, because the biggest problem here is that this needs to be kept under control so that the queens don't get pissed off. And the reason you don't want the queens getting pissed off is because you got to keep the paycheck going to the queens, because if they get mad, they come down and kill everybody, game over, okay? Like I said, it wasn't profitable to keep a war going with the reptilian empire. It was profitable to work with them, right? Anu already had his ego inflated by being the favorite feudal lord over all others. So, of course, he wasn't going to screw this around. He stepped on his son and he says, get him to control. Son says, I can't do something or we're going to be in big trouble. So, this is when Anu sends his other children down there, Enlil's siblings, okay? Two others, brother and sister, sends down Prince Ea, okay? And sends down Nimrasak, Princess Nimrasak. This relationship here between brother and sister, okay, even though they were all siblings, she was on one side of the issue. What you see happening here, as we go along in the discussion, is eventually you're going to realize what gives birth, the feud between him and these two gives birth to this and this. Right? That's why I have to split up like that. Prince Ea is brought in with his sister because the two of them worked together as master geneticists. In other words, the definition of a true god. Okay? And their job was to go into the biological environment of a given planet and create the perfect obedient slave from that environment. Because it was realized early on that if you try bringing slaves from another system into an alien system, you have a revolt, you have a psychological snap, you have an emotional breakdown because they're in an alien environment. So you can't just import slaves from another system. It doesn't work. Slaves have to be fostered from the given indigenous environment. This is what makes them so damn valuable, because you have to put effort into genetically enhancing and modifying that raw genetic material that already exists. When I say raw genetic material, I'm talking about primate ancestors, okay? You see this same issue repeating itself with the Philadelphia experiments. These poor dumb suckers in the Navy were thrown on that boat. Why did they lose their lives? Because they were warped into an alien environment, okay? This was not respected, and the experiment went belly up, right? But they knew about it. They understood psychology real well. There's two other things I want you to keep in mind in terms of the Moorish legacy. Okay, eventually we'll come to these terms, but I'll put it on here now. Guerrilla warfare. In other words, the underground. And the Masonic method of warfare, which is psychological. This one usually overpowers if you've got iron hand compression, but this one is a thorn in everyone's side. Okay? So this is where you'll get this thing going on, the psychological warfare versus guerrilla warfare. Alright? We'll get to where how that term came into existence. So you got these two, master students, brother and sister. Okay? And they're working on creating the perfect beast, and they go through several experiments that are failures. And they're like, you know, we're having a problem here. They couldn't get the beast. Because the thing is, you need to create the perfect beast. Of course, this goes back to what I said before, 666777888, the beast versus godhood, consumer slave versus master investor. Here's where we get the beginning of the beast. And the beast was called the Adama. Okay? Linguistically, look at what's in here. Ad-apa, that which mimics. From apa, you get the word ape. Okay? Ape. Okay? As in Planet of the Apes. Which is also a very good piece of invisible college material. The polos of symbolism in all of the Planet of the Apes movies. Now, what happened was they were trying to get to this, and they were having problems. So they couldn't get the damn thing to be smart enough to obey commands without being too smart to think, therefore I am. That would have pissed off Enlil because he was the one put in charge of the operation, okay? To make the Anunnaki happy, Prince Samia, Princess Nimrod, his sole job was to give the Anunnaki and Enlil good obedient slaves so that middle management would stop revolting and the paycheck would start flowing to the queens again. So, they finally, the thing is, in order to get to this point, they kept experimenting. Prince Hia was at his wit's end. All of a sudden, Princess Nimrasai calls him over one day. He says, brother, come here. He's got a smile on his face. Figured out something at the bottom of the test tube. She finally figured out the proper genetic formula for creating the perfect Adama. So what does this really mean? You have a brother and sister relationship, male and female. It was a woman that created man, and it was a man who put a seal of approval on it. Okay? This ends this this long, ridiculous argument: is God a man or a woman? God is both the man and the woman, represented by the yin yang relationship, which doesn't necessarily have to do with sexual relations between men and women. It has to do with brother and sister relationship of godhood. Okay? The power to create life from the given environment, from the raw genetic material, which was the Adapa. And what you have with the Adapa is this overgrown ape-like thing that could stand upright. That was a key thing. Why? Because if you look at our primate cousins today, they can't stand upright because the muscles in their hind corner and in their pelvic bone won't allow them to. They can do it for maybe a couple minutes, but that's it. They don't have the muscular structure. So one of the adaptations that had to be made, or modifications, was to create the beast with the lower leg power to lift. They already had the upper body strength, which was tremendous, okay? This is why chimpanzees are so damn volatile, and you probably see them in the movies, as opposed to orangutans, which are much more docile. Chimpanzees will kill you, okay? And that was the biggest mistake that was made here, was that primate ancestor us of the chimpanzee was chosen, okay? So not only do you get the obedient Adapa, but eventually along the way, there's that other hot-blooded essence running through that eventually contributes to rebellion, okay? So the Anunnaki start employing the slaves, the Adapas, our primate ancestors, to go to work in the mines. And as is also the situation with the 20th century, we all know how... Yes. Oh, okay, sorry, yeah.
Here he is. Could have been dots, could have been dashes. Could have been nothing at all, you know.
On the Rosetta Stone? I have no idea. I wouldn't be able to tell you. Okay? But an example of a word without vowels, which sounds like it has vowels,
I have one question. I don't see much difference between Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. I mean, there's no difference to me.
The reason you don't see the difference is that one stole from the other two, and the other two come from an original source. Christianity ripped off everything. That's why there's nothing original about it. It gets its God from the Greek Zeus, okay? It gets its angels from the extraterrestrials. It gets the term devil, I'll explain, from the labelism of Enki, okay? Christianity, just forget about that. As far as Judaism and Islam, yes, they do coincide with each other because they come from the original source in Africa, which is known as Kemet. We'll get into that. Alright? I'm trying to speed through the cosmology so you have a foundation to the noble Jurali history. Alright? The Moorish legacy by itself is enough to appreciate, but it doesn't have the same impact if you don't understand the extraterrestrial issue behind it. Alright? Here. Get through that first, this gives it a more into this over here. This by itself, nothing. Alright? So the Anunnaki are using the ape. Now, on the word of Enlil, being the hump that he is, the Anunnaki are working the Adapters to the bone, into the ground, killing them off literally left and right. Now, Ea and Ninrasad, I've just put their blood, sweat, and tears into this creation. They have allegedly a certain amount of compassion that they develop for the creation, as any artist or god would towards his piece of artwork, okay? So they start getting rather pissed off with the way their hostile, sadistic pig of a brother is driving them into the ground. So Ian decides, wait a minute, you know, I'm putting all this damn effort into this thing. I want some for myself, okay? And this is what begins the so-called original sin. Because now he's beginning to disobey through the law. Because there's a feud between him and him. Why? Well, he's in charge by feudal law. He's the older prince, the older brother. He has to be in charge. He doesn't want to be, though, which produces a sadistic hostility towards the Adapter. On the other hand, he's the one that creates them. He's the master geneticist. He feels that he should be in charge and wants to take over. Okay? So you got this magnificent Shakespearean drama developing here. You know, it's very similar to the shenanigans you read about in Hamlet and Macbeth and so forth. So he sets a plot in motion. Now, Enlil had already established no beast would be taught forbidden knowledge. This is why they had to be engineered to obey simple commands. Lift, shove, push, nothing else, okay? But smart enough to remember those robotic commands, okay? So that they didn't have to be retaught every damn time. Ea says, screw that, he starts taking a certain group of them under his own wing, okay, and starts teaching them good knowledge, but he's got to get the beast involved a little more modified, because remember, they just got finished creating a beast that wasn't supposed to understand anything more than simple commands. So what he does is both he and his sister Ninrasad have a rather interesting relationship with another extraterrestrial race, okay? And that particular extraterrestrial race, put this over here, is known as the Ankhils. Okay? Now, what are the Ankhils? Once again, drawing upon the Invisible College, James Cameron did the best job ever of depicting the Ankhils in the movie The Abyss. How are they described? They're described as avionic, bird-like race of beings, highly evolved very far out of three-dimensional existence to higher densities, but they got bored and missed the fun in the third dimension, so part of them came back down to the third dimension. That's a strange concept, which is why James Cameron did a fantastic job of depicting that concept. And of course, it was so simple, so magnificent, and when I saw the movie The Abyss, I was like, transparency. Half in, half out of three-dimensional existence. Are you there? I don't know. I can touch you, but I can't see you. Okay? Half in and half out of three-dimensional reality. Those beings you see, our avionic bird-like race of beings, okay? That's the Ankhils in the Abyss. let's break down the words, you know, like this. First comes the root, also spelled this way sometimes, okay? Now, let's look at that more closely. What is the shape of an Ankh? Now, some people misinterpret it as an angel, okay? It's not an angel, although the word is validated, you'll see in a minute. Avionic, bird-like, race of being. What is an Ankh? Head of the bird, wings of a bird, tail of a bird, okay? The Ankh, coming from the term Ankhios, what had happened was Ea went to them and asked them for a little bit of help with the Adapa, modify them a little bit more. They were missing something. And that thing they were missing was the gene of passion. Henceforth, I think, therefore I am. Without the gene for passion, you're a robot. Okay? We'll put that over here. Gene for passion. Gave them the code, the genetic code for passion. They in turn put it into the Adapa. This is where this elite core starts being created. This elite core becomes known as the Iesu. Okay? What's interesting about Iesu? Iesu, Jesus, Jesus, and also suspected Yahweh eventually. Okay? From Iesu? Mispronunciation would be Jesus. From Jesus, Jesus, an even more bastardized term. And then it's also suspected that somewhere along the way, the syllables for Yahweh also came from this. Which you'll also, later on, which you'll also know as the proper name, and I'll explain why later. The proper name for the one you call Jesus Christ is Guru, Master, Prophet, Isa. Isa comes directly from this too. Okay? Put that right next to it, Isa. Which is also used in Turkey. They still use the proper term to refer to that particular prophet. Gene for passion implemented the Adapa, turns them into the elite Iesu. Now, what are the Iesu now known as? Okay, they are now known as the anointed ones, the gene for passion, the anointed ones. Okay, they are taken into caves, secret caves. Okay, I mean, he is really digging a hole for himself, all right? Since he had a relationship with the Ankhios, okay? And once again, Ankh, gene for passion. Ankhios also becomes Angios, as in Los Angeles. From Angios, you get the word angel. Angel or the Ankhios. This is why you get the confusion about the Ankh being an angel. It's not, it's a bird. But the linguistic derivation is correct. Ankhio, this is why the term angel becomes associated with the term Ankh. It's okay, but it's a slight historical error, okay, linguistically. What also happened too now was that since he had a relationship with the Ankhios, that so-called religious device that is called the Ankh today, it wasn't a religious device, it was a technological device, similar to what you call a microphone or a universal communicator from Star Trek's point of view. He used it to communicate knowledge that much faster to the creation, the anointed ones. I found it because he only had a limited amount of time with these guys before Emma was looking at the watch, like, where the hell is everybody, okay? So, to get this knowledge pumped into them faster and faster, he used this device called the Ankh, which is now what you guys call the Ankh, the angel, or the Ankhio, okay? And the root comes from that. Now, since he was using the Ankh, he becomes known as the Ankh in association with the Ankhios, and this is how Prince Ea becomes known as the Ankh-E. Enki. So that's where the name Enki comes from, Ankh, okay? Eventually, you know, he was known as the Ankh, eventually the I is attached, Ankh-E, okay? So, Prince Ea is his real name, Enki is his pen name, okay? So, this is how he gets to be known as this, okay? So now, known as Enki, Enki, Iesu, alright? All of a sudden, all these words start relating to each other, and they start going in a circular pattern with each other. Enki takes the Iesu into caves. Now, even, I mean, you know, what he does here is from the perspective of these guys, ultimately abominable. You got to keep that in mind along the way, because there's a word that comes out of this later on, and you'll understand why. He goes, teaching them, they become the anointed ones. He's using the arm, pumping it into their brains, into their genetics, into their cell memory, into their racial memory. This eventually will become the Temple of Solomon and the family of man. Okay? What he did, though, aside from using the arm, he also used another process to speed it up. Initially, there was the Ariane technology of mind-controlling radars. Remember I said with this, psychological warfare? They used a particular crystal technology to help Anu and Enlil and Ea program the Adama to do exactly what they were supposed to do. Bam, instant brainwashing. You know, because the mind is no different than the hard drive of your computer. It can be erased. Right? It runs on electricity, so it's easily erased. All right. Well, he goes and turns around and uses it the other way. Okay. So he's using the reptilian. You know, I mean, if you were trying to piss off the queens, this would be the way to do it. He uses that same reptilian Ariane technology to now pump information into the minds of the Iesu even faster. Okay. They become the anointed ones. Enlil, still exhibiting the sadistic labor campaign of destroying the Adapters. One day, Enki, now known as Enki, he's walking through the garden, which is where you get the term Garden of Eden from. And, you know, feeling sorry for the Adapters, because now he's got two classes. He's got the Iesu, he's got the Adapters. Decides to go to the Adapters themselves and help them in a different way, okay? Basically signing his own death sentence. But he goes into the garden, finds the Adapters, starts talking to them. You know, they know who he is. They love him. And he says, you know, how's my brother treating you? And the other went, not too good. And you don't like what you're doing. Mm-hmm. He says, now you got to remember, once the process was set in motion with the Adapters, the point was, in order to reproduce the perfect slave every time, you had to set up a system of mating. This later on was repeated by the Nazis in terms of the controlled genetic mating, okay? Well, in this particular case, one male Adapa was forced to mate with one male female Adapa all the time. Henceforth, perfect predictability as to what kind of slave offspring would be produced every time. It was a way of manipulating racial memory and cell memory in a slave economy, okay? And the thing is, the only way to keep that going was to have it in a controlled biosphere environment. That controlled biosphere is, of course, what you read about in the book of Genesis, the Garden of Eden, okay? And this is where you get the concept of an Adam and an Eve, okay? One male Adapa forced to mate with one female Adapa, okay? And all of them had to do that. They were all tagged, all right, so they would remember who they were supposed to have sex with. And at a certain time of the month, at the ring of the bell, they'd say, come and get it, and, you know, they'd all go in there and go at it, and that would be it, all right? Well, the thing was, that was for all the misery that there was, that was the only form of enjoyment that they had. So now, and he walks into the garden, he says, what if I could show you something that would make your life that much better? He says, you're not going to escape the slave system that you're in. I can't do anything. But I can teach you something that will make your miserable life that much more pleasurable. He says, you know that thing you're allowed to do once a month at the ring of a bell? He says, well, here's a magnificent concept. Guess what? You can do that anytime you want, anywhere, with anyone. Okay? Alright? So they're thinking about this, right? They're looking at each other, and all of a sudden the doctor starts smiling. Right? Well, later on, Enlil's looking around, the Anunnaki looking around, nothing's getting done. Where the hell is everybody? So Enlil goes into the garden looking for them, right? And it goes down, Enki had told him, he said, look, I'll teach you this, but you have to promise and make damn sure that my mother does not find out about this system. Otherwise, everybody's screwed. All right. No, but as with everything, somebody's bound to mess this up big time, okay? Someone's going to make a mistake. Well, sure enough, someone was caught by surprise. Right? Enlo's walking through the garden looking for something. He hears this noise behind the bush, right? So, looks behind the bush and sees a male adopter fully erect, getting it on with a female adopter that wasn't tagged with the same symbol, okay? At that point, the gig was up. Enlo knew it was his brother. He says, where is that son of a bitch? I'll kill him, right? And this, once that went out, then he found out that not only did he do that, okay? Not only did he do that, but he found out that he was also teaching the anointed ones forbidden knowledge, okay? So now he found out about the year. Okay? So now he goes on this unholy, massacre. Starts just killing up, because at this point now, the adopters have been having sex with everyone. This produces a total screw-up in the genetic structure of slavery. Okay? Now you can't tell what kind of product is going to come out, the end result, okay? All these female adopters are threatening with God knows what. And on top of that, to make matters even worse, a select group was picked to be taught forbidden knowledge, and this forbidden knowledge was, of course, the whys and wherefores of the galactic community and where the adopter came from in the first place. Okay, and that's supposed to be teaching the slave where he came from. Okay, right. Because that's where Mary Shelley gets the idea for Frankenstein. Okay, the awakening of the beast, and then the beast coming home to the creator to kill the creator. Okay, so he goes on a rampage, telling everyone looking for his brother. At this point, Andy's got to get out of town, all right, real fast. So he takes off, but he also takes off with a whole bunch of the anointed ones, the Aesu. Takes off to what is now referred to as the Pleiades, and proceeds to continue on with the experiment with the anointed ones to produce what's referred to in ufology as the Pleiades, okay? Another branch of something beyond Homo sapiens, all right? Also related to the human race, the family of men. Okay? Some of the anointed ones stayed beside. Some of the Aesir stayed behind to carry on the good fight. Because they knew the Adabas were getting slaughtered, their own brothers, sisters, someone had to stay behind. So some of the anointed ones stayed behind. Engi takes off with most of them, the lion's share of them, to the Pleiades. What happened was Enlil, now with his massive spaceship armada and whatnot, slaughtering everyone left and right. The anointed ones, the Aesir, are like, we have nothing to go up against this, and we're the only ones who know the truth. We can't afford to go up against him and get killed. So they initiate what is now what eventually becomes referred to as running for the hills. You see this in the movie Braveheart with William Wallace and the Scots. They run for the hills, let the British come, and they go back and attack them from behind. This, because you're dealing with primates, apes, give birth to the term guerrilla warfare, underground warfare, striking hit, striking hit, okay? They go take it off to the mountains. To this day, now, they were also, these anointed ones, these Iesu, are also known collectively as the Adam, okay? This is the Adam, okay? It's in the name, Adam, Om, as opposed to ape, which mimics Om, refers to frequency, awakening the beast, the anointed ones, awakening the gene of passion and forbidden knowledge, okay? And there is a symbolic relationship between the word Adam, A-T-O-M, and the fact that these guys were created at the bottom of the test tube, okay? Adam, Adam, yes, there's a definite significance there as well. The Adam, they're still carrying on that good fight today. You don't call them Adam anymore, you don't call them the Aesu, you call them by another name. Nowadays, you use the term Yeti, Sasquatch. Bigfoot. Okay? Sasquatch. Bigfoot. That's the Adam. Okay? They have carried on the good fight for today. They are living libraries just like that of the blue whales in the sea. Okay? Yeti, Yowie, Berserker. Okay, Berserker is another term throughout every culture. You'll notice, no matter what country you're in on the planet, every culture, every country has a Bigfoot, a Yeti, a Sasquatch, a Berserker, or a werewolf. And at times, the werewolf mythology is combined with the Sasquatch mythology with the word Berserker. Okay? Both the blue whales and the Sasquatch are living libraries. That means they have it within themselves, their own makeup, their own self structure, all this key information of true ancient history, where the human race comes from, our relationship with extraterrestrial entities, family of man, people of color and hue as true custodians of the land. They were locked with that image so that that information would never get lost. And the people of color and hue would be recognized as the rightful custodians of Earth.
How did
I only know that from what I had been taught by other metaphysical teachers. I don't connect it to their only. The only connection I make is that both blue whales and Sasquatch represent Mother Earth. One for the sea, one for the land. And it was done that way on purpose so that if one or the other got wiped out or exterminated, the other stood a better chance of surviving.
Where does that leave the people here? Are we like a link in between these?
Yeah, this is right now that I've explained that much, I can start getting into what you're talking about. Alright? Okay. The revolt went on, endless slaughter now across corporation, feudalism, slave economy. The Anunnaki went to Enlil and said, look, you're killing off all the slaves that are supposed to be doing slave labor, you gotta stop. So, of course, Enlil realizing stops. But what he does is now he realizes he's got to take drastic measures to get the slave population back under control. There's a whole damn revolt going on. The ace who run it for the hills, he's trying to hunt them down. A lot of them did get killed off, a lot of them survived. He's already got an axe to grind against the Adapas, okay? But he's got to stop killing them. So, just to be a spiteful bastard, he decides to go the other route with propaganda. Once again, using the Aryan technology to reprogram everybody. And what he reprograms them into, he wipes their mind. From that day forward, the term Enki or Ea is now labeled as forbidden, as in forbidden knowledge, the tree of forbidden knowledge, okay? He is labeled as forbidden to be spoken. The Adapa or the slave is never allowed to speak that name again and to burn it into their brains in a state of fear and paranoia. He says from this day forward, he will be known as Baal. Okay? Baal. Now, in this type of linguistics, when they wanted to emphasize true despicability, what they did was they added another syllable in front of that, Dia. They called him Dia Baal. So the person that created the human race was now slandered with the term Dia Baal. Diabolo becomes Diablo, Diablo becomes devil. Okay? Now, in order to have the slave believe this, you have to also have something else on the other side making it look that much more evil. So, what does he do? Enlil puts himself up on a pedestal and he says, from now on, you will never utter the term Enlil. From now on, you will call me Gad. Now, from the term Gad comes the term God. So, devil created you, God destroyed you. That's the message here, okay? This is why this becomes so damn volatile and forbidden, because everything you learned is asked backwards. Devil was never that bad, God was never that all-loving, okay? I'm not making him out to be a saint. He had his own selfish methods for doing what he did. But on the other hand, the point is, that which you call the devil and that which you call God are biological brothers tied at the hip in a feudal sibling war, okay? So why the hell are you picking one side over the other when these two assholes are trying to destroy each other in the first place? Right? He's a sadistic pig. Doesn't give a shit about you. And him, well, he knew he was going to start a rebellion that nobody could win. Okay? But in the end of it all, he is the one that saved our asses with something he did before he left, before he got banished from this kingdom, before he was permanently labeled as the above, before he left with the anointed ones. He did something for the adopters. Okay? He pricked his finger and put his blood into the slave. Now from that day forward, and remember, this combined with this becomes the foundation for the Moorish legacy. In terms of real estate investing, global real estate investing, the throne of power, that drop of blood put into the Adapa created the biggest damn enigma that to this day the entire galactic community is still trying to figure out how to get around it with feudal law. Because by putting royal Syrian blood into the beast, he then gave the beast the right to be custodians of the throne of power, custodians of Earth. Made them the rightful blood heirs of this planet, and if you make them blood heirs of this planet, that means they control the entire kingdom. Okay? That was the ultimate step in the back to the system, because even the Satan queens couldn't argue against that. So how do you get around it? That's when he starts his whole propaganda campaign, I am God, my brother is the devil, and starts reprogramming all the slaves. Okay? Now, he's got that going on. With this feuding going on, there's another interesting group who was associated with all this along the way, who we haven't mentioned yet. And of course, you know them already as the Greys. Okay? Now, what's the role that they play? Well, with this going on, and in relation to the Anunnaki, Syrians, and the Satan queens, they operated as the SS Gestapo. In fact, they were allowed to walk freely among the population, and they were known as the stone builders at the time, henceforth stone mason. Alright? They are, and in keeping with the idea of a corporate corporeal body, they are the bean counters of the corporation. They are mathematical calculating little bastards. Okay? Soulless to the core, alright? They have a very close relationship with reptilian blood, even though they were working, they were sent down to keep things in order and spy for the queens to keep these guys in line. Because they knew the feud here, you know, was going to blow up sooner or later. They calculate in their mathematical and logical equations that they can run the whole corporate operation a hell of a lot better in this kingdom than these two imbeciles here fighting with each other, okay? So, they wait. He's thrown out. The slaves are reprogrammed to forget him. Okay? He's in charge by himself now. Okay? But there's an interesting thing that happened. Ea had a son, Marduk. Not exactly the sharpest tool in the shed, okay? And it's in the name, Marduk. What is a duk? A Syrian dog of war. Mar, well, it's a reference to the god of war, okay? Marduk, alright, one of the Syrians, the Greys knew exactly how to manipulate the whole situation to their favor. They played both sides against the middle. They went to Marduk, knowing he was a dumbass, but also the son of Prince Ea. They went to him and said, you see what they did to your father? You want to get even? We'll help you. We'll back you in the next campaign for control. Marduk's like, yeah, because what were the Greys doing? They were banking on inflating his ego because he was too dumb to think any other way. So they blew up his ego and told him, you're the one who should be in charge. We'll back you. Marduk leads the revolt against Enlil, throws out Enlil, which now takes over middle management with the Anunnaki, at which point the Greys realize that with this imbecile at the head of the game, they can easily take over. So they follow through on their plot, go after Marduk, throw him out, throw the Anunnaki out, lock down the whole damn kingdom, and from that point on, they take over the entire operation. Now, of course, with all this going on, you have to ask yourself, what saved their asses from being eliminated by them? Because this was a total violation of the treaties and relationship for producing a bottom line profit for the corporation. Well, the fact of the matter was, they were sent by the Sakai queens, and after they took over, they went free. But of course, this created animosity with Anu, who was the favored one by the Sakais. As you can tell, the history of the solar system is like a soap opera on steroids, all right? So, you've got that going, a total lockdown on the planet. Greys take over. Well, something interesting happens here, okay? From the Greys, they decide, why not a good thing? They decide to, based on the two-party system that already existed, they reinvent the two-party system. Only in their case, they call it, you know, because of course now they are suddenly thrust into the position of upper management, and they wanted to recede into the background. They needed to reestablish a new two-party system to all work for them. So upper management, in this two-party system that's created by them, they invent the Raqqa Pharaohs. Okay? And the Raqqa Shields. Okay? And of course, as you already figured out, from Raqqa Pharaoh comes the term Rockefeller. From Raqqa Shields comes the term Rothschild. Two-party system. Okay? They invented that. Now, they were known as the Stone Masons, and since they were allowed to walk freely among the population like a Schutzstaffel, they became known as the Freemasons. Greys or Freemasons. Okay? This is why there's always this favoritism towards the pale-skinned abomination that does not belong to the family of man. Why? So they get this far here. Okay. Knowing that, in comes the Ankhils, the Moorish legacy. The Ankhils, who had a relationship with Miguel and Minasar, saw all this crap going down. Even though they did not have a direct relationship with what was going on, they couldn't exactly step in forcibly. That wasn't their way. They realized where the gene for passion went and where the royal blood went. Okay? They decided, let's do it that way. This serves as the beginning of the concept of guerrilla warfare operating on the ground. All right? From the gene for passion, from the concept of the anointed ones comes the Moorish legacy. That Moorish legacy is represented by the term Temple of Solomon. And it's in the name, just like the word Adam, Solomon. You break it down to three syllables, Solomon. Sol is Latin for sun, om, sound, sound for light. So om is frequency, and on is Sanskrit for sound for light. Basically, the name Solomon is a linguistic symbolism for awakening the beast, okay? And of course, the Temple of Solomon is symbolically associated with gold, because gold is the perfect conductor of electricity, which brings us back to the concept of Frankenstein's monster being awakened, okay? By using gold as a conduit, the beast is awakened, the symbolism. Some people argue, oh yes, the Temple of Solomon really exists, it really is the gold, okay, whatever, but who cares? What are you going to do when you find it? They're going to put a gun to your head and pull the trigger anyway. Right. So, who cares if it really exists? What matters is, towards this legacy, towards the family of man, it must be understood that the Temple of Solomon is a powerful symbolism for keeping the body healthy and pure. Okay? From what had happened here was that you've got the family of man now, inheriting the Moorish legacy, inheriting the legacy of the anointed ones through the Temple of Solomon, using it as almost like a filter, a spiritual filter. The gene for passion filtered through the Temple of Solomon becomes what you guys know as the passion of the Christ. Okay? Now, the term Christ, a bastardized term, spelled with C-H, this is an Anglo-Saxon English spelling, totally wrong. The original proper spelling of it, it's not someone's last name, it's a title. It's a title for all major prophets. Every major prophet is called a Christ. It is spelled K-R-I-S-T, not C-H. K-R-I-S-T, Muhammad the Christ, Buddha the Christ, Isa, the one you call Jesus, the Christ, okay? Noble Drew Ali, the Christ. Okay? Adam. Adam the Christ. This is where you get the concept of the Christ energy coming through the bloodline of the prophets. It came from the gene for passion that was pumped into the anointed ones, okay? Now, being that that's the graves were not stupid, they knew what was still there. They knew they couldn't, even with the Ariane technology, they couldn't fully erase that gene for passion. They couldn't get to the anointed ones. They were hiding out. And even with the Adapas, they had to constantly keep them brainwashed. And God forbid, they should be taught by the Iesu to wake up and realize their true legacy. Their true legacy as custodians of the earth. You don't want the slave population waking up to that. What had happened was that with the Moorish legacy coming out of Africa, Mother Africa, all right. That's an important term because they not slandered and erased by the Masonic agenda and hence what called the Dark Continent. Alright? What had happened was that there was a certain segment of the population in Northern Africa which started becoming very warlike, losing its way with Mother Nature, losing its connection and responsibility. Remember, custodians of the land, responsibility to Mother Earth. This particular population in Northern Africa that started acting very warlike, troublesome, they lost their way. They began to experiment on themselves, mutilate themselves, to the point where they bled all of the color right out of their skin. A little more color, they became the pale skin, what you now know as Caucasian. They became so warlike and such a big problem that the rest of the Moorish people got together and was like, what the hell are we going to do with these guys? You know, they just won't stop. They're going to overtake everything and destroy us. So they decided to banish them. This is where you get the concept of being banished from the Garden of Eden. Okay? They decided to banish them, and by banishing them, they had to pick a spot to stick them. Well, there's only one continent on the planet that doesn't start with the letter A, and that's Europe. It's in the name, your rope, a rope, the Columbia side. Okay? Europe is named after the African queen Europa. Europe was a dead wasteland and was used as a transcontinental prison to dump all the assholes who were causing a problem, namely the pale skins. So what happened was they cast it out of Africa because they couldn't stay there anymore anyway. They had burned all the color out of their skin, no more melanin. You can't sit in the sun anymore. I burn like a lobster when I go to the beach. So they had to get out of there anyway for health reasons. There were several reasons. One, they were no longer part of the family of men. Two, they were pale skinned, they couldn't stay in the sun anymore. Three, they were destroying the environment, polluting it, experimenting on themselves in abominable ways, producing these defective genetic offspring that you wouldn't even want to speak of. A good example would be the abominations you saw in the Lord of the Rings trilogy, all those disgusting things that were created by Sauron, okay? They dragged them across the deserts of Arabia. This is where the bitterness begins. Their pale skin being scorched by the desert. And dumped them in the cooler, less sunlight atmosphere of Europe. Leave them there. Perfect prison. Why? Because to the north you got snow. To the south you've got the mountain ranges. To the west you've got the Atlantic Ocean. And to the east, lo and behold, out of nowhere comes the Great Wall of China. You have to remember what comprised the Moorish legacy. It was known as the Amexum Empire. Now, the entire Amexum Empire went from Mongolia to South Africa, over to South America, and up through all of North America. They were known as the Asiatic nations, the Amexum Empire, the Moorish legacy. Okay, the family of men. And then you've got this orphan over here called Europe that nobody wanted. Okay? And of course, with the Great Wall of China, the academics say, oh, the wall was built to keep the barbaric hordes out, but no one ever bothers to ask who the hell the barbaric hordes were. The point is, it was built to keep them in, so they couldn't go anywhere. Alright? And of course, in referencing the mountain ranges, there was one particular mountain range, you got the Sierra, the Nevada, the Caucasus. One particular mountain range called the Caucasus that a lot of them hung around. So this is how the term Caucasian becomes associated with the pale skin. It's not even a real term. Okay, it's like, well, isn't the term Negro to describe black people? It just means black, and that's why it was picked. It has nothing to do with genealogy. Caucasian is also a dumbass term. So, this is how those ridiculous things come about. But what had happened was that they were casted out. They were embarrassed. they realized, once they were dumped in Europe in this barren, dead wasteland that meant nothing to anyone in the family of men, they realized what they had done wrong. This is where you get the concept of like Adam and Eve feeling embarrassed and wanting to cover themselves, okay? Whereas before that, they ran around naked. But they were so embarrassed about what had happened, they went into this massive psychological denial about the whole thing. They started inventing all sorts of other bullshit mythology, monkeys coming down from the tree, even to the idea of being born of a she-wolf, okay? This is what they were grasping at straws because they couldn't admit that they had been banished from the family of man, lost the color from their skin, and were no longer part of that family and flock. And this is the great sin they committed against themselves. That's why they were banished. Well, the idea is, who created a rebellion within the family of man? Who created this rebellion in the Moorish legacy? Much the same way as the CIA does it to every country, these scumbags, in an effort to get even with the family of man, because the family of man had the gene for passion, the passion of the Christ, they started that insurgency in North Africa. Okay? And this is how they began to experiment on themselves. Now, what were the Greys trying to do? Well, one thing, they were trying to destroy this. They had a vendetta against that, because they knew it came from the Ankhils, which were associated via infanticide. On top of that, they were also looking for a good, obedient slave race, right? And what better way to do that than to corner someone who's just been casted out and embarrassed for their own sin? So, race, who themselves, of course, always favor the, yes?
Did you sum up?
Oh, okay. You're gonna have to stop, huh? Okay.
Yeah.
5 hours.
Okay. The Greys go to the casted out pale skins and they say, do you want to get back on top of the food chain? Do you want to get even? Because of course they didn't learn their lesson, and the Greys knew that by approaching them early on, they would be able to capitalize on that feeling of vendetta and viciousness. So they say to them, we'll put you on top of everything. If you obey us from this day forward, we will give you all the technology you need to go out there and do one thing for us. Colonize the living hell out of everyone and destroy the family of man. Destroy them, destroy them, destroy them. So from that day forward, those original European pale skins sold out the rest of the human race by agreeing to it, and by agreeing to it in feudal law, that means all of their pale skin descendants were now obedient to that system. And this is why, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Europe shows up on the scene as a world superpower, going out, destroying, colonizing, and massacring everyone in their path. Okay? Doing it to Africa, doing it to the Middle East, doing it to the Western Hemisphere, the Americas. This was their agenda, their motive, their Masonic operation. They were known as the original Freemasons. By gaining the allegiance of the outcasted, casted out Paleskins, they then handed off that mantle to the Paleskins. And this is how the extraterrestrial connection of Freemasonry becomes an earthbound Freemasonry. That's where Freemasonry came from. And it was created solely for the purpose of burying the Moorish legacy. This is why when you see this crap on the History Channel, and they just, all they talk about is these damn white scholars and academics. Oh, Freemasonry's gone. You know, well, if you're asking the enemy, of course they're going to say that, okay? Try asking a dark-skinned black Native American or a black African. See what kind of an answer you get from them, okay? But we're so busy labeling these people as with the bows and arrows and spear chopping that, you know, the so-called established community won't listen. But all the answers are there. You're just not asking the right people. You have to go to the other 70% that represent the majority of the population. So that's where it comes with that. So along the way, these prophets, there's no such thing as a pasking prophet. Prophets are meant for those who are oppressed. 70% of the planet is oppressed by the other 30%. Pasking prophet would be an abomination. Okay? There's no such thing as a pasking prophet. The the sad thing that black masons will never be allowed to learn as lackeys for their white mason counterparts is that they'll never be allowed to become 33rd degree masons, because if they did, they'd be given a $10,000 passport in the Vatican to go to the House of Omar in Jerusalem and see the perfectly preserved body of Guru Master Prophet Isa, Jesus Christ, and what they would see is a black man. So, there's no such thing as a Palestinian prophet. This, of course, also helps us disseminate truth from fiction in terms of apparitions and visions and crap like that. If you're looking at, you know, some extraterrestrial, paranormal, or supernatural apparition, and you think you've seen the Virgin Mary or Jesus Christ or Joseph, the first question out of your mouth is, were they white or black? If they were white, they saw something else. They didn't see that. Okay? So, any of this crap you hear about, you know, the Virgin Mother coming and she's described as, you know, white, porcelain, pure, Caucasian skin. Okay? There was something there, but it wasn't that. If you read the book, Heavenly Lights, The Apparitions of Fatima and the UFO Phenomena, you'll see how all those so-called religious things, which were skewed towards white Christianity, belong to the realm of alien contact, definitively and scientifically. Okay? But I'll leave it there. I hope you can watch. All right, I'm going to keep up with doing something.
All right. Go fast around a little something. And first, what if you can, we want to give you a little transcription and stuff. Okay? And then he'll stop. But if you continue now, for the best of things.
If you guys want to ask questions, go ahead. Yes.
Your description of the ascension of Europe and what their mission was, mm-hmm. or is.
Yeah.
And if you look at the mission, a lot of people have been hurt, a lot of people have been programmed, but people have gone to Europe, things like that. There's been a lot of...
That engages in tribal warfare because of that 30% abomination that controls the natural 70% that's supposed to be territory. So, this is the thing that's going on.
Are you suggesting genocide of all of this?
No, what I'm saying is that all the pale skins have to be absorbed back into the family plan. Alright? This pale skin has to go. Now that may take, you know, another 100 years, another 500 years. So don't hand me this crap about alien contact being around the corner when those pale skins still exist. And if those SOBs do show up on our doorstep, it'll be a wolf in sheep's clothing, and you should run for the hills because they're coming a little too early, which means they have other extensions. Alright? Yes?
I thought there was a question that creates something that has a body about a soul.
The body has to have a soul.
It has to have a soul. Mm-hmm. So, once the body deteriorates and dies, where does the soul go? If it was created by, I believe, in crew.
The, yes, that's another interesting thing. Symbolically, the gene for passion is the soul. I think before I am, that is the soul.
Okay.
Without that gene for passion, you are nothing, you're an empty, hollow husk of being commands.
So what's it got? It doesn't die.
This process is a learning process called the process of reincarnation. And this is, yes.
Oh,
thank you.
Sorry. Okay. Yeah, let's give him a
good job, Bob. Good job, Bob. You have to do it again. You're going to
get that out. I'll come back again. Yeah. Because all those kinds of things.
I'll definitely come back again.
God is going to trouble these waters. look like a band that Moses led.
God is going to trouble his water, waiting in the water, waiting in the water, children, waiting in the water. God is going to trouble his waters,
my Lord. Deliver Daniel, Daniel, Daniel. Did my Lord deliver Daniel? Then why not every man? Now did my Lord deliver Daniel, Daniel, Daniel? Did my Lord deliver Daniel? Then why not every man? A man went down to the down to the river, Lord. Man went down to the river. Went down there for to pray. Man went down to the river. Man went down to the river, Lord. Man went down to the river to wash his sins all away. He washed all day, he washed all night, washed till his head was sore. Washed all day, washed all night, till he couldn't wash him no more.
Hey.
Man went down to the river. Man went down to the river, Lord. Man went down to the river. He went down there for to pray. Man went down to the river. Went down to the river, Lord. Man went down to the river to wash his.